I'm really quite honored that, you know, in this series of talks that Coconut Theatre has been arranging during this lockdown. I'm quite honored, but also a little embarrassed to be talking in that series, in a series of such great stalwarts who have done so much work in Indian theatre. And people I really look up to, some of my idols, some legends of Indian theatre, who are here, who have been speaking. And I'm MD Pallavi, who's, you know, I'm from Bangalore, and I was born into a family of theatre artists. My grandfather was a theatre maker. He was a playwright. He was a theatre artist. He founded many institutions. He did a lot of street theatre in Bangalore. He did proscenium plays. He founded a theatre school here in Bangalore called Abhinay Taranga, which was a theatre school for people who were working. It was a Sunday school of drama for people who had different jobs but wanted to engage with theatre, wanted to learn theatre and maybe also then seriously pursue it. So it was a kind of a stepping stone for people who were outside the world of theatre and wanted to get into theatre. So I was born into a family of, you know, this kind of a family where there was always theatre happening and there was always some kind of art some way or the other. I have been acting in plays, I've been working in theatre for a very, very long time because of, you know, where I was born. I kind of grew up in the middle of plays being made and plays being performed, being rehearsed, being prepared, backstage, on stage, everything. And because of the how lucky I was, I got to work with some extraordinary theatre people, you know, starting from B.V. Karanth to one of our legends who I just also recently worked with, Prasanna, and so many major theatre makers of Bangalore, of Kannada. Primarily Kannada theatre and English theatre in Bangalore. And then I also got an opportunity because of Rangashankara, which is one of the best theatre spaces in India. I got an opportunity to do some international collaborations and work on them also. So I've been lucky because of, you know, where I was born and the kind of people that I met throughout my life to have done this kind of theatre and to have worked with these great, interesting people. And I have been seeing the videos where a lot of people who have been speaking have spoken about their experiences in theatre, about their life in theatre. I think I'm quite young in that way to have a lifetime of experiences to share that would be worth your time. I probably will do that at a later stage. Hopefully, I'll have enough to, enough experiences that would be worth recalling and speaking about. I do have a lot of experiences, but I think I'm quite embarrassed to be speaking about that. But what I do think I want to share in this discussion today, in this talk today, is what I have been thinking of late, what I have been exploring of late, and what I think is a very interesting possible way of exploring, you know, improvisations or acting itself for a performer or an actor. And I will share that with you. Topic for today is finding your rhythm. And I have been looking into this for a period of time now, looking at how an actor or a performer can explore rhythm and can use the concept of rhythm and try and shape his or her performance. Can working with rhythm be a possible way of exploring the acting or the performance of a person? So the actor, basically what does the actor do? The actor responds to a script, to a text, to a subject, to a thought or an idea, and then starts exploring it with a director or with a writer or with a team of theatre makers. And depending on the training of the actor and the form that the play or the performance that he is currently working on, he or she will use a number of techniques to sculpt that performance. So today I want to talk about the use of rhythm specifically as one of the ways of finding that performance, or the understanding of rhythm as a possible lens to perceive and understand your artistic practice, if related to a certain performance or also generally to your artistic practice in general. So let me begin from the very beginning. What is rhythm? Rhythm comes from the Greek word rhythmos, which means, rhythmos comes from the word Rhine. So Rhine is a river. So rhythmos means a particular manner of flowing. Flowing means flowing of the river. So rhythmos means a particular manner of flowing. It's a manner of movement, a manner of behavior, of kinesis. And in the Indian context, Lord Shiva, who is also considered as the Lord of the stage, he's called Sabhapati. So Lord Shiva is also the Lord of rhythm. And rhythm is, in the Indian world, rhythm is laya. Laya literally means to be absorbed or to be one with. And layate means to move or to go. So both contrasting meanings are derived from the same word. It gives the qualities of both being still and to be in movement. And laya is directly connected to time, kala. And in the Indian world, laya is considered as a measure of kala, as a measure of time. So going back to Greece, Plato said, rhythm is a binding quality to motion and time. And Stanislavski defined rhythm as a combination of moments of every possible duration, which divide the time into a variety of parts. There is another, there are these, I mean, I'm trying to give you various, how different directors and theater makers have understood and defined rhythm. Plato said that, Stanislavski said this, professor for theater studies, Patrice Pavis said, rhythm is a systematical structuring of repeatable units. John Martin says, rhythm is the division of silence and stillness into organizable and repeatable units. So rhythm basically is often seen as a system for structuring actions and sounds into units, into groups, into patterns to which meanings can be ascribed. Lecoq ascribed the bond between the audience and the performer to rhythm. He said the theatrical relationship between the audience and the author through the actor is a rhythmical agreement. And that you can sense that it's true, because when you see a play, you have often heard the use of the word, there was something off in the rhythm of the play. It was not okay. There was something off, that the play did not, you know, it was not a normal audience member will also use the word rhythm in that sense. So the connection between, Lecoq says, the connection between the audience and the actor or the performer is a rhythmical agreement. So, I mean, through all these definitions and all these various interpretations of rhythm, we can very clearly understand that rhythm is something that is units. There are units, there are groups, there are patterns, and all this is ascribed to rhythm. Rhythm for the layman is all around him in his daily world, in his normal world. The heartbeat is a rhythm, as all of us know, and all the time we refer to it. Changing of seasons is a rhythm. So from the heartbeat to the changing of seasons, to the rotation of planets, to the blinking of an eye, everything is rhythm. There are patterns, there are repetitions, there are tempos, and there are cycles that are unique because of the way time is embedded in each of these rhythms. That is what makes that particular rhythm unique. So in theater, rhythm is not just an abstract concept. It's not just a notion. Rhythm has its physical dimensions and manifestations in the body of the actor, in the text of the character, in the silences between the actors, in the shadows and lights and the changing of these shadows and lights. And you see it happening on stage, as you experience the rhythm of it as an audience, and you create the rhythm of it as a performer or a director. And all art is about elaboration. Elaboration of a moment, elaboration of an idea, and to find the right rhythm for that elaboration is particularly the work of the actor or the performer. I read in this one fantastic book that, you know, when Peter Brook went and saw Grotowski's play Acropolis, he said apparently he was very disturbed by it because the rhythm of the piece was unpredictable. And he said it was like jazz, unpredictable like jazz. He said it was an understanding of certain rhythms that allowed the performers to create that unpredictableness, to break through the barrier of rational communication and to access something deeper. Similarly, when you watch a Bhutto or a Kudiyattam performance, you can sense that the rhythm of these performances is something that you wouldn't have encountered in your normal world. And the nature of that rhythm in the performance offers a different kind of elaboration to you, and it forces you to experience time in a very different way. Bertolt Brecht apparently also encouraged the use of unconventional tempos in the delivery of his lines or his texts, just to explore the different meanings or the various possibilities of interpretations that could emerge from an unconventional tempo or an unconventional delivery of these lines. So then, how does an actor start understanding and exploring rhythm in his or her performance or in his or her practice? To start with, an actor or a performer can start here, which is all rhythm has three basic units. It has the present, it has the before, and it has the after. Or it has the present, it has the past, and it has the future. Or, as Mayer Hold would put it, it has the otkaz, it has the posit, and it has the tochka, which literally means it has the and, one, two. Mayer Hold divided every moment, every action into these three parts. And, one, two. And, one, two. A performance is a continuous chain of these three units. The preparation for an action, which is called the pre-action. The release of the action. And the moment of pause after the action is completed, or you can say the completion of the action. And the actor has to work on every moment of his performance, breaking it down to its smallest units, which is the and, one, two of every moment of his performance, and then should string these together, which will give the performance a quality of honesty and naturality. And the performer's journey emerges moment by moment by moment by moment. Whether the form is conventional or whether it is unconventional, whether it is familiar or unfamiliar, building the performance moment by moment, beat to beat, breath to breath, equips the actor to be able to fly within the framework of the form. And Mayer Hold was very particular that the actor, the performer, should be very aware of the difference between rhythm and meter. Now, what is the difference between rhythm and meter? You could say the difference. You could say rhythm is the frame of time and meter is the exact pattern inside that frame of time. So, I mean, a very literal example of what he said or strongly believed should not be done is understanding of rhythm as something that is a specific beat or a specific tempo or a very particular distance between the beats. Now, if you were to go by this particular kind of concept of meter, understanding a performance and practicing it with meter, then it would be the same every time. It would be like three people could do the same thing. It would be in sync. That is not what Mayer Hold wanted his performers to do. He said, now this would be like the equivalent of a circus performer using rhythm in his or her performance. For the circus performer, rhythm has to be precise. It has to have the quality of meter. There has to be a very specific understanding of how this rhythm is moving, and it has to move the same time every time, because his entire performance and maybe even his existence, his life depends on it. He has to reach from one place to the other, or you know, all such complicated physical actions depending on the perfection of that particular rhythm or meter. And he said, in contrast to it, a theater actor and a theater performer should be very aware that of course you should be able to do sync, sync your rhythm with the other performers or with whatever is required on stage. You should be able to do it, but you should be very aware that that is not how you should do it, and that you should be aware of the frame of the time, frame of the rhythm, and within that you should allow for free for a free exploration of that time, and that would bring a quality of reality to it, of a quality of an organic quality to it every time it was done. Meyerhold also apparently used a lot of musical language in his rehearsal rooms to work on improvisations, to work on explorations. He used these musical terms: legato, which means smooth flowing; staccato, which means short, separate, you know, cut-to-cut, equidistant phrases; luft, or the musical pause, which is a suspension, it is a breath. He also used musical tempo descriptions like grave, which is solemn or very slow; andante, which is modern or walking speed; allegretto, which is a quick speed; scherzando, which is playful; and capriccios, which is very, very lively. He used these different descriptions that are from the musical world to explore, to improvise with his actors. And he felt it was very important for his actors to work with rhythms of music, while being, again, like I said, very aware not to fall into the trap of synchronicity, not to fall into the trap of a meter. And I understand this concept and this method of exploring and maybe building a performance with units of rhythm and time very similarly with a grammar that's close to me and close to my practice, which is the grammar of the Indian musical traditions. We have the Ativilambit and the Vilambit, which are very slow and slow. And there is a very specific distinction between grave, the tempo, the description for very slow in the Western tradition is grave. The word itself is called grave. The tempo is called grave because it is very solemn. In the Indian musical tradition, vilambit or ati vilambit does not denote solemn. It also denotes solemn. It also denotes a variety of expressions. You could have ananda in vilambit. You could have viraha in vilambit. You could have shringara in vilambit. You could have veera in vilambit. So it really depends on how you explore the tempo. And so vilambit and ati vilambit in our musical language mean extremely slow and slow. Madhyalai means a little faster than vilambit, but it's still a slow walk. It's not a fast walk. And dhrit is the beginning of a fast tempo. Dhrit, ati dhrit, it can go faster and faster and can be a gallop of the horse also. So this I understand, Meyerhold's idea that, you know, it is important for an actor to understand and work with rhythm and musical language. And that I think is something that I also am very excited by, because I'm a musician and I am an actor, and I try, even without trying, I am constantly using my knowledge of music in theater and my knowledge of theater in music when I perform. And this I think is something that could be a very useful tool for actors Now I spoke about ati vilambit, vilambit, madhyalaya, dhrit, all these ideas which are from the Hindustani classical tradition. But there are also numerous folk idioms and folk jargons and folk musical descriptions and understandings of different kinds of understanding of music and the world of music in our different folk traditions. The tempo or the rhythm of a performance of a Yakshagana will be completely different from, let's say, a Ramlila or a Swang, or the way that rhythm is used itself sometimes becomes a very important element in the definition of the form. So I think when I try and find ways of building my performance, when I try and find ways of improvising on my performance, these are various rhythms and musical ideas that I draw from. And I'm very excited by what, the smallest unit for an actor would be a moment. And how do you make a very nice chain of moments to create your performance? And that, I think, if you watch a Kudiyattam performance, what does a moment mean in a Kudiyattam performance? When is the moment beginning and when is it ending, and when is the next moment beginning and ending, is very different from when you see a tamasha, and the tempo or the rhythm of the tamasha, where are the moments, which is the most singular unit in the performance of a tamasha, or a performance of a nautanki, or a performance of a yakshagana. If you can very clearly dissect these moments and identify the pre-action, action and post-action in all this, I think there are a lot of possibilities for an actor to be able to draw from various tempos, various permutations, combinations, energies, also musically tone, timbre, all this. And I mean, I haven't even this itself is huge in terms of what can be done. There is still text, which itself is rhythm. Text is written in a way that gives us the rhythm of the performance. This is if you are working with text, of course. And it in itself, text allows you to find a specific rhythm for the character. It allows you to change the rhythm for a character. Like I said, Bertolt Brecht always allowed for unconventional tempos in the delivery of his text, because text, rhythm gives meaning to text. If you change the rhythm of delivery, then the meaning that emerges out of that delivery is changed. Rhythm is not just how fast or how slow, it is also the silences in between, the silences before, the silences after, the speed, the divisions, everything is rhythm. And hence, when you play with rhythm in text, which everybody who works with text does all the time, it allows you to explore meaning. And to marry these two, to marry the physical possibilities of rhythm and possibilities of finding rhythm in text, both together, I think, will allow for a very enriching experience for the actor as one of the layers that can be added to your performance as an actor. This is what I had to say, and this is something that I have been thinking about for a very long time, and I have been exploring and using in my practice. And I would like to now invite any questions, if there are. Would it be possible to give an example of when the meaning might change because of rhythm? That's the simplest, actually. All the time. When you say there have been fights and arguments in real life between couples where they say, it's not what you said, it's how you said it. And that has been like something that a lot of people fight about. It has to do a lot with rhythm, the rhythm of delivery of the text. I don't know, I mean, what qualities should the actor have for rhythm? Like I said, even to start thinking about rhythm itself will allow the actor to equip himself more and more in terms of, you know, to listen to music, I think, is a very basic thing that an actor should acquire. Listen to different kinds of music, listen to different forms, not just one specific form, because that kind of gives you just a very small world in terms of rhythm and harmony, but to explore music itself with all its different forms and genres, and to try and see if there's anything, any inspiration that an actor can take from that. How do you prepare before the performance? How do you build your performance? Like I said, this is a very good exercise. I mean, there are two exercises which I think are very, very interesting and very, you know, enabling for the actor. One is the you know, this is something that I did with my, you know, German director when I did the two plays that I did in Germany, to look at a minute as a unit of time, and to see how many things you can do in the minute, or how the actor explores the minute itself, whether you don't do anything, you do something, you how do you move, and how do you explore the whole minute as an actor, becomes a very interesting exercise to be able to understand how you perceive a minute, a very basic unit of time, on stage as a performer. Because what happens is, a moment, a second, will not be the same experience. The experience of a second will not be the same, or the experience of a minute will not be the same when you are in a different state every time. If your state of mind is that of, different emotional states, different states of movement, different states, different spaces give you a very different experience of the minute. So to be able to understand time itself, the flexibility of time in a performer's, world itself enables the performer to do a lot more. How will you differentiate rhythm in prose and lyrics? Again, that's I think that's it's a very I mean, you can see the difference, right, in prose and in lyrics. The difference is in rhythm, in the way the gaps are built into it, in the way the silences are worked in it, in how long the sentences are or how short the sentences are, in how the message is delivered, whether it is delivered at the end of the paragraph or after every line. I mean, there is a certain quality of repetition in lyric, which probably also could be there in prose. I mean, these are quite nebulous, you know, ideas. Prose can turn into something poetic or, you know, lyrical very very smoothly also. Ashok ji, you're saying, as you told, you're an actor, same time you're a musician. How do you correlate it for your performance on stage and how much it has helped to the best performance on stage? A lot. My experience and my skills as a musician, as somebody who understands rhythm, harmony, music in general, it enables me to build my, performance better as an actor. Because I'm always fascinated when I see, because I'm a musician who thinks musically, and I'm also an actor who thinks emotionally and all, who also is emotionally responsive to the text. There is a layer in my understanding of a performance or a play or, you know, whatever I'm doing, that I see it also as a musical composition, a rhythmic composition. I see the whole piece. It could be a play, it could be anything. I see it as a musical score, and also as a musical score. So that helps me understand it in another layer for my understanding of it. I have to tell you this very interesting experience that I had. I was in Germany and I was there for the Documenta Festival. There is a Documenta Arts exhibition that happens once in 4 years in Germany. And I was there because I did this play with my German, director, Sophia Stepf. I did C Sharp, C Blunt with her. And I was there for the rehearsals and the shows of it. But we went to Documenta. And there was this one artistic performance by an art critic. So the art critic did a performance herself, which was that the performance was that anybody could come and give their painting or art, piece of art to her, and she would spend some time with that, and then she would, in front of the person and in front of an audience, write a review, a piece of criticism or a critical appreciation of that piece of art or painting, in front of the others. So the performance was that we could see her think through the criticism or her response to the piece of art, because behind her was a huge board screen where we could see everything. She was typing, she was deleting, she was thinking, pausing, then she wrote, that was a performance. So I went to her because, my friend also said, why don't you go and ask her? So I went to her and I said, can you do a critical review of a music performance? And she said that I've never done that. I said, would you give it a try? That would be an experiment, for you and me. So she said, yes. So I sat in front of her and I sang. And I sang a classical piece. And she listened to it and she responded to it as if she was seeing a painting. As if, she said straight lines. She spoke about it in terms of lines and colors and, texture. And I found that very interesting because I sometimes see theater or a painting as music. I see it as rhythm. So I think it's very, very important for an actor to be able to understand performance, to be able to understand the world also through rhythm, also through harmony, through sound, and these basic elements that are so important for him or her as an actor. These are the tools that we use. I hope I answered your question. I hope I've conveyed what I set out to speak about to all of you. And if there are any more responses to what I've said, please do write to me, or you can respond here, and I will be very happy to read it and respond as well. Thank you very much for this opportunity, and I hope it was worth your time. Thanks.